And our musical guest tonight is Cage the Elephant with their new hit single, Take It or Leave It.
You should know by now that I'm right for you.
Cage the Elephant, a band with sound exploration that has not been matched since the Beatles.
You're too sweet, we love death, keeps us holding our breath. Blanket of silence makes me wanna sink my teeth in deep, burn all the evidence. This world at times will blind you, still I know I see you. Come a little closer.
Their live shows are trademarked by the eccentric onstage persona of lead singer Matt Schultz. He's done crazy stunts.
I broke the fourth metatarsal in my foot, separated my ribs from my sternum, had stitches.
And even been known to wear a dress on occasion.
Got so much to prove. God, don't let me lose my mind. I've been trying real hard to.
Their music videos are emotionally charged and thought-provoking. Take for example the video for Aberdeen, in which a dragon that just wants to make friends with people can't stop killing them and is gunned down by the military. Another tearjerker, the video for Shake Me Down, features a dying man. He wanders through a fort he made as a child and sees his life flash before him before he dies. The guys do have a sense of humor, though.
And I threw up because I jumped on top of a roof that was painted silver, and it was really hot up there like an oven. And then I came down off the roof, and I threw up because I was hot. No, I'm not grumpy. I'm really fucking happy right now. And I'm in a really good fucking mood.
You just absolutely up the show every single time. Just tell us your secret. Like, how do you keep on making them better?
Coffee. Lots of espresso.
Occultish rituals. No, I'm joking.
Oh,
no, we have a Ouija board backstage.
No.
You are my guys. I'm going to grow old with this band.
You're our guy.
Thank
you. We love you. Really.
Thank you.
Thank you for
are
all the
sunshine.
All the support over the years.
Yeah. It's so easy to support this rock band, right?
Loving you.
The name for the band, Cage the Elephant, actually has a funny story behind it. One night, as they were leaving a club at which they had just performed, a seemingly mentally disturbed man approached them.
Like, as he's walking towards us, I was like, oh, shit. Like, excuse me, sorry. Anyways, but when he got to us, he just kept ranting and raving about, like, you got a cage the elephant, you got to this, you got to stop this, and blah, 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 and we're like, it messed me up for a couple weeks.
Cage the Elephant was formed in 2006 by five friends from Bowling Green, Kentucky. Matt and Brad Schultz, Jared Champion, Daniel Tischner, and Lincoln Parrish. We are shown scenes of their hometown in the video for In One Ear from their debut album. At the time the band was formed, Matt was living with his older brother and lead guitarist Brad Schultz. They were performing gigs on the side at local venues and coffee shops. There wasn't much to do in this small Christian town. They'd go to crazy parties rife with booze and drugs. Many townspeople misjudged the band members and called them devil worshippers. But growing up poor, they were used to being misjudged. Say that we ain't got the style, we ain't got the class, we ain't got the tunes, it's gonna put us on the map, and I'm a phony in disguise trying to make the radio. Although they grew up with most basic necessities and had loving parents, it wasn't always easy. They shared a room with two other siblings in a two-bedroom apartment. Kids at school looked down on them and made fun of them for their dirty hand-me-down clothes. Their father had been a truck driver, and so he wasn't around much. Left to their own devices, the boys went looking for fun and excitement together from a young age. Once accidentally setting fire to a cornfield.
And so one time we went out into a cornfield that was behind the house.
We saw a whole box of my Aunt Patty's.
We got naked down to and made loincloths. And we started a fire. And we were dancing around the fire. And we had these corn cob pipes that we made. They were smoking. And the farmer came and he caught us. And we were a bunch of naked kids like burning down his cornfield.
They were raised by protective Christian parents and had to sneak listening to the very kind of music that inspired them.
My dad one time was like, Matt got a Green Day tape.
There was a song about suicide and he was terrified, you know, that it was gonna like influence me. So he snapped the tape in half with a pair of pliers.
Morgan Viola, a 7-year-old girl from their neighborhood, was kidnapped. Her body was found months later in Tennessee in an unsolved murder case. They note this as a life-changing experience and an innocence lost among them. The song Sweetie Little Jean was inspired by the incident and more generally losing someone to depression. Sweetie Little Jean, where did you go? Everyone's been searching high and low. At the beginning of high school, their parents got divorced, and the boys moved into a trailer park with their grandparents. Matt had previously been a football player, but quit when his mother started dating his football coach, and pursued music as an act of rebellion. The boys' father had been a singer and guitar player. He was fairly good and had a few close calls with success in the music industry, but never caught his big break. Matt was in two punk bands in high school, Left Nostril and Perfect Confusion, along with Brad and KG Elephant's drummer, Jared Champion. Jared also came from a musical background. Both his father and grandfather have been drummers.
We were in a band, me, Jared the drummer, and my brother Brad were in a band called Perfect Confusion.
KG the Elephant's bassist, Daniel Tischner, had a father that was also a singer/songwriter. His father had actually played with Matt and Brad's father, whom he met at the Christian commune where Daniel grew up.
Daniel started hanging out about 6 months before we all kind of parted ways. He came to one of our shows and just really liked the band, started hanging out with us, went to Colorado with us. He shot it, trying out, so we're all like, all right, whatever, you know? He came out and he was, sorry, Daniel, he was terrible. Like, absolutely terrible, but he's an extraordinary musician. You know, so, well, he was like, give me a second chance, please give me a second chance, you know, I want to try it again. I'm all like, oh, I don't know, Brad's like, come on, man, just give him a second chance. And he comes out and he just absolutely fucking nailed it, blew our minds, you know. So that's how Daniel came into the band.
After high school, Matt became a plumber. In their town, it was either get a 9-to-5 and go to church or party and do drugs. Matt began writing lyrics at work. When his boss caught him, he had to start writing lyrics on walls and pipes. Then he would go back at the end of the night after everyone had left and write them down. The inspiration for their first hit single, Ain't No Rest for the Wicked, has a funny story behind it, and actually came to him on the job after he witnessed a construction worker that was selling drugs. The transaction was done not too far from a police car, and the man complained about the police when Matt asked him why he didn't just stop. His response was, "There ain't no arrest for the wicked man." Matt ran back to his truck where he wrote the saying down on the back of a paper plate. This understanding that inspiration can strike at any moment may be why most of KG Elephant's lyrics are so authentic. Looking for a bite. He said, "Give me all you got. I want your money, not your life. If you try to make a move, I won't think twice." I told him, "You could have my cash, but first you know I gotta ask, what made you want to live this kind of life?" He said, "There ain't no rest for the wicked. Money don't grow on trees. I got bills to pay." Matt quit plumbing and stated that if he didn't, he felt like he probably would have been at that job his whole life. Brad was previously a telemarketer and had just started working at the sandwich shop when Matt came to join him. Taking a job with less responsibility meant more time to focus on music, and living together made it easier to collaborate on new ideas. Matt recruited one more member, lead guitarist Lincoln Parrish, who was a 15-year-old boy that had only been playing guitar for 2 years.
Then Lincoln, it's even kind of a funnier story, did this, I guess this advertisement on MySpace that was like, Perfect Confusion is looking for a new lead guitarist. We've been getting offers from this 15-year-old kid that's like, "Please let me be your lead, let me try out for your lead guitar." And we're all like, "Fuck, dude, there's no way in hell we're gonna let some 15-year-old try out for our fucking band, you know?" Sitting at this B-dubs, it's where everyone's mom wins. And Jared's like, isn't that Lincoln over there, man? It ended up being Lincoln. And we asked him to come out and try out for the band, or we're just like, "Why don't you come out and jam with us?" And he comes in and he fucking tried out for the band, and he was perfect. He blew our minds away, you know? So.
The band was working with a Canadian publishing company that invited them to come play a show in Toronto, stating they needed more Canadian acts. It was 2007, and the show was South by Southwest.
Which is funny because we got that tour because someone at our label lied to them and told them we were a Canadian band.
Get some good Canadians.
Right, yeah. Right out of the gate, you had credit.
And they were like, "You all sound pretty weird for Canadians. Yeah. What's going on?" I was like, "What? I'm from Kentucky."
Yeah. The band didn't feel the need to explain they weren't actually Canadian. They wanted to get away from town where the temptation and pressure to sit around and take drugs was looming over them. Opioid abuse was reaching an all-time high in the Midwest at the time. According to Brad, they knew about 15 people in their town that had died from a drug-related death. Things couldn't have worked out better in Canada. They were scouted at their show in Toronto and signed to Relentless Records. Their manager was able to release their album in the UK, so the guys made the decision to move to London, England to promote their record. Lincoln's parents had to sign over a release of guardianship to the band because at the time he was only 16 years of age. Cage the Elephant, the album, was released in 2008 and has since gone gold. Ain't No Rest for the Wicked, their very first single, was featured in a popular video game, Borderlands 2. I know I can't slow down, I can't hold back, though you know I wish I could. Another Ain't No Rest for the Wicked. The album did surprisingly well. Their early sound was heavily inspired by punk and had political anti-fascist themes discussing society's ills. It's a new creation, total domination. Change across your shoulders, social captivation. Kill our leaders, persecute our teachers. Criticize our culture, crucify rethinkers. 2011 saw the release of Thank You, Happy Birthday. This album explored the grunge rock sounds of the Pixies and Nirvana. Okay, alright, okay. KG Elephant was about to be brought in the spotlight, winning their first MTV award, the VMA for Best Rock Video, for Shake Me Down. In the same year, the band was voted Best New Artist in a reader poll for Rolling Stones magazine. Thank You, Happy Birthday debuted at number 2 on the Billboard 200. It was after the second album that Matt quit taking pills. He went to his father's house and quit cold turkey. Matt has said he was afraid to quit drugs because he thought it would make him less creative, but found for himself that the opposite happened and the floodgates of creativity were opened up to him. The band really started to develop their unique sound by the third album titled Melophobia. The definition of melophobia is fear of music. They chose the name to express their fear of making music that only appeals to what is popular instead of making music that is original and comes from the heart. Either I'm in heaven or I'm in hell. Am I losing my mind here? 'Cause I can't tell. I've been waiting for answers for way too long. Seems that I'm always waiting around. Spiders in my head. The video for Cigarette Daydreams features Matt's wife at the time, French model Juliette Bukes. You can drive. Lincoln Parrish left the band after the third album, which caught some of the band members by surprise because their success was just gaining momentum. Getting the most attention
at the time. So, like, how are you able to feel okay doing that? Like, because
I mean, it was definitely a little scary at first. Like, and I had people, like, friends being like, are you sure? Like, you know, like, you're kind of an idiot, man. Like nobody else in the world would, like, walk away from that. And you know, it just felt
Lincoln
like,
found a passion in producing music and even produced some songs for other artists between tours. He left on good terms, although Matt and he didn't talk for a while after he left.
I'm doing what I love and, like, you know, everything's going well. Like, you guys are still, like, killing it. Like, you know, it's all, like, good. At first it was a little weird, but now it's very, like, it's all good.
Lincoln now has his own production company, Talkbox Rodeo, and has recorded music for Penicillin Baby and Western Medication. Nick Bockrath became Cage's new lead guitarist in 2013 after Parrish left. He had played for Nico's Gun and Morning Teleportation, another band from Bowling Green, Kentucky.
I guess the past two albums are new for me. I've been in the band like 6 years.
Okay, yeah.
So that was the first two ones that I was on with the band. And so that was probably new, obviously, yeah, for all of them. But yeah, I don't know. We're always getting into new music. We're always influenced by stuff. So
okay.
It's sort of just very natural, but it also, we don't want to repeat ourselves ever.
Yeah.
It's like too easy to do the same thing or something.
Tell Me I'm Pretty was released in 2015, and they received their first Grammy for Best Rock Album. Trouble was produced by Dan Auerbach of the Black Keys. Got so much to do, got so much to prove, God, don't let me lose my mind. Trouble on my left, trouble on my right, I've been facing trouble almost all my life. Mess Around was inspired by Outkast. The band takes influence from different genres. Matt has said that Cage the Elephant prefers to be seen as a musical band. They don't like to feel boxed into a certain style, citing that nowadays people don't listen to a song for its genre, but rather based on how they're feeling at the time and how the song makes them feel. Madan Minster joined the band in 2017, but had been touring with them since 2013. He is a keyboardist, guitarist, does backing vocals, and also writes lyrics.
My whole keyboard rig, you know, we do everything live. We never do sequencing or backing track or anything like that, and we never will for sure, but this allows me to have a lot of production versatility on stage without having to play with fake tracks or to a click or any of that stuff, so.
Their newest album, Social Cues, was released in April of 2019. It explores how society expects people to act a certain way when they're grieving, and how we express or don't express grief. Matt had recently divorced his wife, and in the past 2 years, they lost three close friends to drug overdose, one being a cousin and another a childhood friend. Prior to the album, Matt spent 6 months in hotel rooms across the country trying to cope with all the loss. After writing the intense lyrics to Goodbye, he needed a 2-week break before continuing production.
I prayed for you. My heart's an ashtray and I lost my mind.
Ready to Let Go was greatly inspired by the divorce, the lyrics citing a trip he and his ex had taken to Pompeii, where they saw the statues of people that had been frozen by ash. He related to the statues because at the time he felt that their relationship was unsalvageable and there was nothing he could do about it. He wrote the lyrics when they went back to the hotel while they were still on the trip. Matt has said one thing that he has struggled with as a songwriter is using his life experiences for inspiration without revealing too much.
We both knew this day was coming. As we slow danced, I became your statue frozen. Times I wonder, are we just a puff of smoke? Yeah.
He conveys some of this frustration through images in the video that are meant to cause the viewer discomfort, and on the cover in which he is wearing a sex suit, symbolizing the forbidden which cannot be spoken of.
No, sis, trying to change it. I must drive these matches, never had control. I'm ready to let go.
It's the authenticity of Cage that has kept fans hooked, and they have taken their fans on a journey most artists couldn't pull off. From gritty punk to blues, indie rock, alternative funk, and pop. They have not only opened our minds with their lyrics, but different music styles. In a time of extreme polarization, they have given us something we didn't even know we needed. Unapologetic honesty, all in a musical fusion of which anyone can find something to appreciate.
And it's just so incredibly touching that we're able to take so many negative things that happened to us and turn it into such a positive thing. That's all I have to say, Matt.
And I wanted to say that God is love, love is alive. For everybody who's out there who's struggling, going through things, don't give up hope. This year was the highest level of teen suicide that our country has seen. And I just want to say, love is alive. Love will remain forever. Thank you guys so much.
Their name may have been a decision made on a whim, but Cage the Elephant is all about identifying the elephant in the room that no one wants to talk about and putting it in a beautiful golden cage where it can be enjoyed, examined, cried over, and celebrated.
If you're terrified to sing it, you're probably on the right path.